So what is PIDS? For over 40 years, the Philippine Institute for Development Studies, or PIDS, has been the country's foremost socioeconomic think tank. It conducts rigorous and objective policy research and analyses that help the government in crafting relevant policies, plans, and programs in support of the country's long-term vision and development goals. PIDS pursues its mandate through three basic programs: research, dissemination, and outreach. Through its research program, PIDS identifies and prioritizes studies, develops proposals, and conducts research on priority areas. The results of these studies are then disseminated through different platforms, publications, online resources, PIDS Corner, seminars, and the Development Policy Research Month, or DPRM, held every September. To shed light on key policy issues, the advice and expertise of the Institute's research fellows are also sought by policymakers, government agencies, private sector, and civil society. Since 1977, PIDS has completed numerous policy studies on a wide range of development topics. This brand of service has then translated to policies and programs that have improved the lives of every Filipino. Philippine Institute for Development Studies, service through policy research.
In need of references for your research? Do you want a search engine that is easy to navigate? And do you want it free? If you are a student, researcher, or teacher looking for socioeconomic references and materials, then SERPI is for you. To access SERPI, just visit the PIDS website at www.pids.gov.ph and click the SERPI widget. Or type serp-p.pids.gov.ph. SERPI is an online database of socioeconomic studies and materials produced by the Philippine Institute for Development Studies and other academic and research institutions. SERPI has a wide variety of socioeconomic materials such as journal articles, books, working papers, policy notes, research papers, and newsletters. SERPI has 52 partner institutions that contribute publications to the database. SERPI has a wide coverage of materials encompassing 20 research themes. You can search by keyword or author, by publication type, by research theme, or year published. SERPI has more than 7,000 materials with full text that you can download for free. Enjoy searching! Visit SERPI now and follow us on Facebook. You may also send a message for inquiries.
Oo, dapat din ang pag-aralan yung batas at polisiya para mas makita nila yung epekto at resulta nito.
Pag nanuli tayo, wala tayong maisasagot. Kaya dapat pag-aralan din natin.
Oo, dapat nilang pag-aralan ng mga batas at polisiya para malaman nila kung epektibo ba ito sa karamihan o magiging problema lang.
Kung walang basehan ang isang batas, basta na lamang ipatutupad at walang pulso na kinukuha sa mga mamamayan, eh, mahirap.
Mahalagang isailalim sa masusing pagsusuri ang mga polisiya at programa ng pamahalaan bago pa man ito ipatupad. Dapat ring ipagpatuloy ang pagsubaybay o pagmonitor sa mga ito habang ipinapatupad hanggang sa matapos ang kanilang implementasyon. Dito pumapasok ang tungkulin na ginagampanan ng Philippine Institute for Development Studies. Ang PIDS ang siyang sangay ng pamahalaan na naatasang gumawa ng pag-aaral at pananaliksik at magbigay ng rekomendasyon sa mga mambabatas at iba't ibang sangay ng gobyerno tungkol sa mga programa at polisiya sa pamahalaan upang masigurong matugunan nito ang socio-economic needs ng ating bansa.
Pag pinag-aralan, mas effective!
Welcome to the PIDS webinar series. Before we start the webinar, we would like to give you a few reminders. For attendees, your microphone is muted upon entry. In case you have a question, the moderator will read it during the open forum. For those attending via Cisco WebEx, use the chat box located at the lower part of the screen. Click the chat icon, type your name and affiliation, and your question, and send to all panelists. You may send your questions while the presentation is in progress. The moderator will read them during the open forum. For Facebook viewers, at least two questions from the comment section will be read by the moderator during the open forum. We will moderate all questions to ensure that they are relevant to the scope of the presentation. Thank you for joining us, and we look forward to your active participation.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the PIDS webinar series where we discuss development issues based on data and evidence. I'm Sheila CR, and I will be your moderator. Friends, we are tackling a very interesting topic this afternoon concerning the country's largest social assistance program, the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program, or the 4Ps. I'm sure many of you are interested to know whether the 4Ps is meeting its objective of reducing intergenerational poverty by improving the health, nutrition, and education of our marginalized sector. Since the government launched the 4Ps in 2008, PIDS has kept a close watch of this program. It has conducted several studies to provide inputs towards the refinement of the program design and implementation. And this afternoon, we will hear the results of the recent studies conducted by the PIDS assessing the impacts of the 4Ps. To officially open our event, may I call on the president of PIDS, Dr. Celia Reyes, for her welcome remarks. Ma'am Cel?
Begin, I would like to acknowledge the presence of the following. We're very honored today to have Sec. Dinky Suliman, who started the program, the 4Ps program, and some of our 4Ps beneficiaries with us this afternoon. Let me also acknowledge DBM Undersecretary Laura Pascua, NEDA Assistant Secretary for Policy and Planning Carlos Bernardo Abad Santos, NEDA Regional Director Milagros Rimando, PhilHealth Health Finance Policy Sector Acting Senior Vice President Dr. Leo Douglas Cardona, DILG Bureau of Local Government Development Director Annalisa Bonagua, Bureau of Local Government Finance Director Pamela Quezon of the Department of Finance, sorry about that, Presidential Management Staff Director Cherry Pai Feliz Maraya, and from the Senate Economic Planning Office, we have Director General Ronald Golding, Executive Director Merwin Salazar, Director Maria Cristina Pardalis, and Director for Economic Planning Policy Studies, Sarah Sesmi Tafan. From the House of Representatives Congressional Policy and Budget Research Department, we have Executive Director Novel Bangsal, Service Director for Economic Policy Research, Elsie Gutierrez, and Service Director for Budget Policy Research, Pamela Manalo. And from the Social Security System, we have Vice President of Management Services and Planning Division and concurrent Vice President of Risk Management Division, Eleonora Cinco. We have Cooperative Development Authority Executive Director, Ray Elevaso, Juvenile Justice and Welfare Council Deputy Executive Director, Maricris Caburral, Securities and Exchange Commission Director, Rachel Esther Gumtang Rimalante, and our very own PIDS board members, Dr. Gilberto Lianto and Attorney Rafael Lotilla. We also have from the private sector, Social Weather Stations President Mahar Mangahas, Manila Water Philippine Ventures President and Chief Executive Officer Virgilio Rivera, In One Go Technologies President Ramon Garcia, Chemonics International Country Director Melissa Agabin, CPRM Vice President for Development Consulting Manjit Sohal, Cargill Philippines Corporate Director Christopher Ilagan, and Nutrition Foundation of the Philippines Executive Director Maria Lourdes Vega. And from the academy, we're joined this afternoon by Polytechnic University of the Philippines Director and Head of Academic Programs Rufo Bueza, Siliman University Director for Research Enrique Oracion, Cagayan State University Director for Extension Josie Bass,
Mariano Marcos State University Director for Extension, Aris Reynold Cahigal. Cavite State University's Gender and Development Resource Center, Director Susan Tan. Mindanao State University Iligan Institute of Technology, Director Nelia Balgoa. Mountain Province State Polytechnic College President Rexton Chacas. Lansalan College Foundation President Fidelino Tawagon. And this afternoon, we have Philippine Embassy in Beijing, Third Secretary and Vice Consul Diane Lipana, ASEAN Secretariat Director Rodora Babaran, who was also very much involved in the program, International Institute of Rural Reconstruction Country Director Emilita Oro, Unahakbang Foundation President Oli Lucas, Kabalikat ng Migranteng Pilipino President Luther Calderon, BPO Party List President Jake Pineda, Microfinance Council of the Philippines President Ibarra Malonzo, Masaganang Sakahan Director Daniel Agustin, Bayan Academy Director Carlos Sagun, and Community Economic Ventures Executive Director Maros Pareno Apostol. Let me also greet our guests, colleagues from the government, academia, civil society, media, private sector, as well as those who are watching through the PIDS Facebook page. I'm also very pleased that we have with us this afternoon some of our Four Ps beneficiaries. I was scrolling through the chat box and I saw some of them introducing themselves. So good afternoon and welcome to our second webinar for the year. Today, PIDS Senior Research Fellow Dr. Aniceto Orbeta will be presenting three studies which he co-authored with PIDS Supervising Research Specialist Chris Ann Melad and PIDS Research Analyst Nina Araos. In particular, he will be sharing with us the results of the impact evaluation they did for the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program, or the 4Ps, which is a flagship social protection and poverty reduction program of the government lodged under Department of Social Welfare and Development, or DSWD. As most of us know, the 4Ps started in 2007 under the leadership of Sekdinki Soliman with 300,000 beneficiaries. To date, the program covers about 4.3 million households. According to the Department of Budget and Management, the government has allotted 106.8 billion pesos to the 4Ps program for 2021. Starting in 2020, there have been significant adjustments in the subsidies for program beneficiaries. This is stipulated under Republic Act 11310 or the 4Ps Act. Household beneficiaries are now receiving a monthly subsidy of 750 pesos from 500 pesos for health. Educational assistance for senior high school has also increased from 500 pesos to 700 pesos, while those in junior high school and elementary school remains at 500 and 300 pesos respectively for 10 months. This is in addition to the 600 peso rice subsidy the households are receiving monthly. So what is the role of PIDS in the 4Ps? Nagtatanong, may nakita kong tanong sa chat box, ano bang objective ng event na ito? Under RA 11310, PIDS is mandated to conduct a periodic assessment of the program every 3 years to evaluate the effectiveness of the program. It also states that every 6 years after the effectivity of the act, PIDS shall recommend to the National Advisory Council whether the cash grants shall be adjusted to its present value using the Consumer Price Index as published by the Philippine Statistics Authority. To comply with the provisions of the Act, PIDS undertook three studies to assess the impacts of the program. The first two studies show that the 4Ps has a positive impact on the health and education of children. The third impact evaluation, or the IE Wave 3, was intended to reassess the program impact on short-term and intermediate outcomes on health, education, household welfare, and other social behavioral domains. The study found that in general, the program still has desirable impacts on most of the target education and health outcomes of children and pregnant women. The study also found positive impact on household welfare and social behavioral outcomes for both adult and children beneficiaries. The follow-up qualitative study found that there's a need to reinforce the knowledge on maternal care among beneficiaries, boost supply conditions in health, especially on staffing, and address barriers to employment of 4Ps beneficiaries. Meanwhile, the RCT cohort study found that timely exposure to the program contribute to lower incidence rates of underweight and child morbidity. Dr. Orbeta will present to us the specific results of the impact evaluation, as well as their recommendations to address the issues and opportunities for improvement of the program. We also want to hear the insights and comments of colleagues from other sectors. This afternoon, we have with us the SWD Assistant Secretary Jocelyn Juane, Department of Health Supervising Health Program Officer Ms. Luz Tagunicar, and Asian Development Bank Economist Mr. David Anthony Reitzer. Let me take this opportunity to thank ASEC Niwane, Ms. Tagunicar, and Mr. Reitzer for accepting our invitation. It is an honor to have the three of you in our webinar. To our viewers, I hope you will stay until the end of the webinar and actively participate during the open forum. And I'll give back the floor to the moderator. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mamsel. Like you have been scrolling the chat box, and I saw some questions from our 4Ps. Some of them are interested to join the 4Ps. Nais lang po naming linawin ang ating pong webinar sa hapong ito ay tungkol po sa pag-aaral na ginawa po ng PIDS tungkol sa naging impact ng 4Ps po sa mga beneficiaries nito. Kung kayo po ay may tanong kung paano po sumali sa 4Ps, kagaya nga po ng sinabi ni Ms. Miramel Laksa ng DSWD, maaari po kayong bumisita at magtanong sa inyong local social welfare office sa inyong munsipyo. However, kayo po ay welcome na makinig po sa ating talakayan ngayong hapon. At meron po tayong open forum mamaya kung saan ay pag-uusapan po natin yung pong resulta ng mga pag-aaral. At maririnig din po natin yung mga komento po ng ating mga inimbitahang panauhin mula po sa DSWD, sa DOH at mula po sa Asian Development Bank. Okay, so friends, we now go to the presentation which covers the results of the three PIDS studies on the 4Ps, and all of these studies, as mentioned by Mamsel, were conducted by Dr. Aniceto Orbeta, Ms. Chris Ann Melad, and Ms. Nina Victoria Araos. Dr. Orbeta is a senior research fellow at PIDS. He has a PhD in economics from the UP School of Economics and a postdoctoral degree from Harvard University. His fields of expertise include demographic economics, social sector, impact evaluation, applied economic modeling, and information and communications technology. Chris Ann Melad is a supervising research specialist at PIDS. She obtained her master's degree in development economics from the UP School of Economics, and her current research involvements are in the areas of social protection, human capital development, and program evaluation. Nina, Chris Ann, and Dr. Orbeta are joined in the studies by Nina Araos, who is a research analyst at PIDS. He has a bachelor's degree in political science from the University of the Philippines, Diliman. The presentation will be given by Dr. Orbeta. So over to you now, Dr. Orbeta.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I might warn you that I'll be speaking a little bit faster than usual because we have limited time, so and we have so much material to cover. So to start, many of you may have wondered what has happened to the biggest, perhaps one of the longest running social protection program of country, Pantawid Pamilya. We have heard a story or two about the program. What we present today is a story based on an analysis of data gathered between November 17 to February 2018, according to an evaluation design. This is the third of the series of impact evaluations of the program. The first one is done in 2011, the second in 2013. While these studies had been presented internally to technical working groups consisting of representatives from DSWD, PIDS, and donor agencies like the World Bank, AFP, and UNICEF, this is the first time this has been presented publicly. We would like to mention, too, that DSWD is the primary data collection. The three of us have been working under the guidance of a technical working group mentioned already, and that group also included Drs. Vic Paqueo and Dr. Sergio Reyes of the Philippine Institute for Development Studies. If you haven't noticed yet, the URLs are given in the invitation if you are interested in the full text. Next presentation covers three papers. The main study is the regression discontinuity design. Which is the primary impact evaluation covering the short and medium-term impact of the program. Second is the qualitative study, which looked deeper into the results of the RDD study. Qualitative studies usually done when there are controversial results, quote-unquote. Here we go back to do a qualitative study to find some explanation for portions of the RDD report that can't be explained by the quantitative analysis. The third paper, we called RCT Cohort Studies, is a companion study to our to the RDD analysis to exploit the randomized treatment assignment in the first wave to answer longer term impacts of the program. We thought that the three studies together will be able to explain the what happened to the program better. This is the outline. I'll first provide you a brief background, continue on with methods and the findings, and end with the recommendations. For the program overview, those who have not heard of the program or are not familiar with the program, this graph encapsulates what the program is supposed to do. The program, the 4Ps aims to break the intergenerational cycle of poverty. That is, low-income families will have children who have will not have received proper education and health services. And when these children become adults, they will have low human and social capital and become either unemployed or get low-paying jobs and become parents of low-income families, and the cycle goes on. The program aims to break the cycle of poverty by encouraging poor households to invest in health and education of children. That is, keep the children in school and healthy so that they will have better human capital and have better paying jobs and not become parents of low-income households. This is the program theory. In a nutshell, the theory says that the program pays cash grants to encourage or incentivize poor beneficiary households, as well as monitor their compliance to conditions on health, education, and family development. Conditions include like attending 85% of classes of education, pregnant mothers visiting clinics for every two months, mothers bringing their children to clinics every 2 months, and attending the monthly family development session. Compliance to these conditions means that increased utilization of health, higher educational participation, and better parenting. This in turn will result in better education and health outcomes of children and mothers. And these children will grow to become productive adults that will have higher income and thereby break the cycle of poverty. This is the wave one finding summarizing, and it's done by using a randomized controlled trial, assigning household randomly between treatment and control. Here, both the treatment group and the control group are eligible households. Data collection was done in 2011. The result says that there's an increase in enrollment among children 3 to 11 years old, an increase in school attendance as well for children 6 to 17 years old. Severe stunting was reduced by 10 percentage points, and encouraged mothers to avail of maternal health care services. Children take vitamin E, take deworming pills, and did regular weight monitoring. Beneficiaries also spend more on health and education and less on vice and goods. So contrary to the common notion, there's no evidence that the adults beneficiary work less or made less effort in finding work. The second wave studies is summarized by this. This is done in 2013. By this time, the program has covered almost all areas in the country, with beneficiaries nearing 4 million. So it was no longer possible to implement a randomized control trial. So the next best method used was regression discontinuity design, where the control group are non-eligibles. The main results are the program keeps older children in school, and gross enrollment rates of children 12 to 15 old is higher for purpose children. The vitamin A take-up and iron supplements and the deworming pills are all higher for purpose children. The program promotes facility-based services and access to professional postnatal care. The program also contributes to reducing hours of child labor among poor children. Okay, so let me now go to the research design and starting with the regression discontinuity design, the main method of the main study. The objective of the evaluation is to reassess the program impact in short term and immediate term. Like in wave two, the program in 2017 has already covered most of the poor households. It was no longer possible to do a randomized control trial. By the nature of the design, it requires a substantially larger sample size than an RCT. To have a sufficient power for most major outcomes, it needed approximately 7,000 households in the near poverty threshold. We allocated this 7,000 households in the 30 city and municipalities nationwide. Data collection was done in November 2017 to February 2018. Okay, so let me try to explain RDD in simple terms so we can have a good perspective of its strengths and weaknesses. Suppose this is your target population. If you can arrange the population using a variable called the running variable, which in our case is the proximity test scores, a measure of income, option, and if you can define an eligibility threshold that separates the beneficiaries from a non-beneficiaries, like a vertical line. And finally, if your outcome of interest does not jump, like the green line in the threshold, then you have satisfied the RDD. So long as you limit yourself to a band like the one in shaded form, you are on your way on doing a good impact evaluation. This is what RDD is all about. But suppose after evaluation, after treatment, you observe that the beneficiary has some changes, causing you to observe a jump in the outcomes of the interest at the threshold. The difference in the outcomes between the beneficiary both below the threshold and non-beneficiary above the threshold is the impact on the program. That is the RDD in a nutshell. It highlights its weaknesses. It has strong internal validity as if it is randomly assigned, but it has at the same time also highlights a weakness, which is the results pertains only to the observations near the eligibility threshold or the shaded area. Okay, so that's RD. The next study, the RCT cohort analysis design exploits the RCT assignment in wave one to study the longer term effects of the program. The wave one RCT withhold treatment of control groups by about 18 months. We call it the lock-in effects because timely provision of Pantawid Pamilya benefits that includes time critical inputs in a child's life are likely to have a larger effect when provided during a specific period than if provided outside that period. Think of nutrition or immunization as example of time critical inputs. This study needed 2,500 households drawn from the original treatment and control barangay in Wimban. So this household also needs to have specific children born in specific periods. Okay, so in estimating the impact, this figure tries to illustrate this. Children and or mothers in treatment are presumed to have received the program benefits within the critical period, while children in the control period, because they are not participants during that critical period, to receive it outside of the critical period. After several years, you can measure the impact of that difference in receipt of critical inputs in terms of nutrition, health, education outcomes, as well as between treatment and control households. The hypothesis is that the children who receive the program benefits at the right time will have better outcomes compared to children who have received benefits outside of the critical period. Now, turning now to the qualitative study, as I have said, the qualitative study designed to gain additional insights to explain select controversial results, quote unquote, of the RDD study. We actually particularly look at issues in nutrition, as you will see later, and maternal health care and labor outcomes. We use FCG and KIs with program stakeholders to do this study, and thematic analysis of the interview results were conducted. So the qualitative, the primary data collection of the qualitative study includes FGDs, where program beneficiaries are asked to gain insights on their knowledge, attitudes, and practices on topics of maternal health and child health. Key informant interviews with program stakeholders were also used to record their experiences about the program implementation and beneficiary behavior. Okay, so we are now ready for the results. So and the results are presented by broad themes. So we start with the reproductive health and reproductive and maternal health. Okay, So here is the, before I present the results, I'd like to explain to you the scheme of the presentation, which to make us understand. There are always two bars comparing Pantawid and non-Pantawid households. In addition, in each of the bar, there are two results. One is the sharp RD results, where we assume that the eligible got Pantawid benefits represented by the shaded bars. And the other one is the fuzzy RD, where we adjust for the presence of wrongly assigned observation units, i.e. eligible not getting benefits and non-eligible getting benefits. Our friend David Racher from ADB, who is actually one of the discussants, has recommended that we present both. So this is presented here. And this is represented by the outline bar, not the shaded bar. So there's an outline bar and a shaded bar representing both the sharp RD and fuzzy RD results. Okay, in case of the sharp RD results, when the bars are shaded dark, this means that the difference between Pantawid and non-Pantawid outcomes are statistically significant. If the light shaded, this means that the difference is not statistically significant. For fuzzy RD, if the line is solid, this it's implied that statistically significant results, and if the line is broken, this signifies that the results are not statistically significant. Okay, now that you have an idea of what the bars represents, let us go to the results. First, here you see that the program is shown to encourage trial use of modern family planning methods by 5 to 7 percentage points compared pairing non-Pantawid compared to non-Pantawid beneficiaries. Notice that the bar is dark shaded, so it's significant, statistically significant. But on the right-hand side, also the fuzzy RD is continuous lines, so fuzzy RD is also significant. But sustained use on the figure on the right, is not statistically significant. It is lightly shaded, and the same thing for fuzzy, it's also broken. So the lack of sustained use may be due to access issues like availability of supply or capacity to buy, and experience during the trial use, like dissatisfaction with the method, health concerns and side effects. For prenatal care, there's no significant difference in the prenatal care checkup at least once. But we find a positive significant impact of a decrease of 12 percentage points on availment of prenatal care checkup at least 4 times in the daily the duration of the pregnancy. This is the recommended frequency by DOH. This is a welcome result because they recommend, as I've said, this is recommended by DOH. The Pantawid Pamilya only requires 1 visit per semester or 3 visits. So this is more than what's required by the program. This is an improvement. This improvement is maybe because of the reinforcement of the FDS. For postnatal care, we find no impact on the availment of within 24 hours as well as within 72 hours. This finding seems to indicate that there is an unequal appreciation among the beneficiaries of the value of postnatal care relative to prenatal care, even though both are required by the program. In the qualitative study, the difference in prenatal and postnatal care is one of the issues that we wanted to go back and check using qualitative methods. We find that both Pantawid and non-Pantawid mothers are aware of the importance of antenatal and postnatal care. However, awareness on the antenatal care is higher compared to postnatal care. In some interviews, participants neglect to mention postnatal checkup for mothers when they ask about proper healthcare practices after pregnancy. We also find high compliance in observed attendance in antenatal care checkup for both groups, but inconsistent compliance in the case of postnatal checkup. So there is this result. The result in quantitative studies, it seems to be borne out by the social the qualitative study, where there is an even knowledge between awareness in antenatal and postnatal checkups. In terms of birth attendance, for skilled birth attendance, there's no impact on overall skilled birth attendance. However, the attendance by a doctor among beneficiaries is 10 percentage points higher compared to non-beneficiaries. The results may indicate a shift in the preference towards doctor-assisted deliveries among beneficiary mothers, or change in preference of the beneficiaries from small to bigger health facilities where it is more likely that a doctor is available. Now let's turn to child health and nutrition. For weight monitoring, next slide, regular weight monitoring, which is once a month according to the program, among children 0 to 2 years old is higher among beneficiaries by up to 15 percentage points. Regular weight monitoring, which is once every 2 months among children 2 to 5 years old, is higher among beneficiaries as well by 9 to 12 percentage points. It should be highlighted that despite the positive impact on the program, on weight monitoring, as we can see here, the proportions are exceptionally low for both groups. Weight monitoring every 2 months is a condition for children 2 to 5 years old. And we see that the proportions doing this are quite low, even if it's a condition of the program. So the low proportions may be due to one, lack of awareness of its value and importance, and two, access or supply issues, or a program failing to monitor children. The qualitative study revealed that the 4Ps actually bring the children to because of the conditionality, but you see here that the proportion is still small. So in terms of vitamin A, there's a high intake among beneficiaries 6 months to 6 years old. This result is consistent with the previous IEs impact evaluations. There is no discernible impact on complete immunization, however, for 12 to 8 months. This result has been consistent throughout three waves of the evaluation. The qualitative study revealed that there is an equal access to vitamin supplementation for 4Ps and non-4Ps. Vitamin A is administered house to house or at the health center. Daily vitamin supplements are usually bought by parents due to limited supply in health facility. There appears to be no difference between 4Ps and non-4Ps in terms of attitudes towards immunization. The respondents are aware of the importance of immunization and follow the immunization schedule of health centers. It was, however, found that the provision of immunization services is lower in rural areas. Now, going to deworming, in the case, a positive impact is observed on receiving deworming pills at least once, at least twice, by 8 to 10 percentage points with higher proportion for Pantawid Pamilya. However, we see that there is no statistically significant difference for deworming at least once for 6 to 14 years old. And perhaps the explanation is that it's the proportion that is doing one deworming once is quite high. So the qualitative study revealed that most parents allow their child to be administered with deworming pill. And some fears and misconceptions are still there in some areas. It was found that deworming is provided by all health facilities visited by this study team. Next, we have results on the dietary practice. There is a higher likelihood of being fed vegetables, 8 to 10 percentage points among Pantawid beneficiaries, but there is no significant impact on exclusive breastfeeding. This result suggests that nutrition outcomes observed are not due to current dietary practice, but maybe due to past practices and other practices that accumulated. The qualitative study reveals that there is no consensus on breastfeeding information. Although many of the interview participants stressed the importance of breastfeeding, there is no consensus on the appropriate period of exclusive breastfeeding and the timing of introduction of other foods. Parents may need are knowledgeable about proper feeding practices and importance of nutrition of young children, as found out in the qualitative study. Now, let's go to the anthropometric results. In terms of being underweight and wasting, there's no significant impact on the likelihood of being underweight and incidence of wasting. The next slide, please. In terms of stunting, there appears to be a higher prevalence of stunting among Pantawid children by 5 to 7 percentage points. And in addition, there's also a higher prevalence of severe stunting by 5 to 6 percentage points among Pantawid children below 6 years old. This result is surprising because in wave 2, we found no impact on nutrition. And even in wave 1, there was even a significant reduction in stunting among Pantawid children by about 10 percentage points. So Okay, so we'll try to qualify these results by what we found in the cohort study. The cohort study, however, shows that a 2.9 percentage points reduction in the likelihood of being severely underweight among children in the treatment group. In addition, there's no impact on nutrition outcomes, although the rates are lower in treatment than compared to control. The results on nutrition comes to show that the receipt of the program input during the first 1,000 days results in better nutrition outcomes among children, counteracting the results of the RDD. Now, in additionally, the RCT study also, cohort study, finds that there's a lower incidence of diarrhea morbidity incidence by 3.1 percentage points, and fever by 4.5 percentage points. So there's no impact on the incidence of cough and vaccines and preventable diseases. Okay, turning to the qualitative study, the qualitative study finds that only a small proportion of respondents reported that their children are targeted for feeding programs due to inadequate nutrition status. Most feeding programs are conducted by the daycare center and cover the whole class. So there's no targeted program. The health facility visits for growth monitoring usually ends with a collection of weight and height of the child. It's also found that there's a very low awareness of the first 1,000 days program for both four-piece and non-four-piece program. Only one municipality from those visited discussed said that the first 1,000 days program was discussed in FDS. Now, here's the supply side condition that we found that the health facilities reported to be convenient access for respondents in terms of cost and distance, which is a nice thing to hear. But respondents often express satisfaction also as well when asked about their overall opinion about the health facilities in the community. However, despite some issues faced when you ask more questions, because in government health facilities and in government hospitals are affordable, if not free of charge. Health facilities reported, however, shown to be understaffed, as shown here by the ratios of target ratio of the doctors 1 to 20,000, you have 1 to 30,000 nurse, and so on and so forth. That you have the ideal ratios that's desired, indicating low staffing, understaffing of most of the facilities. Okay, we can now turn to to education and child labor. In case of enrollment, it's shown here that there's no statistical significant difference for enrollment in younger ages. It's also notable that there is a relatively low enrollment for 3 to 5 years old. This has been going on in the survey, the mothers or guardians are asked why the children 3 to 5 years old were not enrolled, and majority of the respondents reported to their mind child is too young or unprepared to go to school. For 6 to 11 years old, we also did not find a significant impact. Next slide, please. But this is just less worrisome compared to 3 to 5 years old, because the enrollment rate here is already at almost universal at 98%. So it will be very difficult to find difference at that level of school attendance. But with older children, 12 to 17 years old, we see a positive impact on enrollment rates4.5 percentage points higher. And the results indicate that the expansion of the program to cover older children has translated to increased utilization of education services for older children. And for age-appropriate enrollment, we also didn't find significant impact on 3 to 5 years old and 6 to 7 years old. And next slide, please. And we found age-appropriate enrollment difference for children, for older children, 15 years old, but not for 16 to 17 years old. Okay, for dropout rates, we didn't find significant difference, although in 6 to 11 years old, you have a higher proportion for non-beneficiaries. Now for child labor, now we find no significant difference was observed in child labor, both in terms of incidence of child labor and time spent on child labor. We also found that among children that work at least once in the past 12 months, 9 or 90% of them are enrolled in school. This means that the children who are engaged in employment are also in school. This may indicate that the children engage in income generating activities to supplement the grants in order to pursue schooling. Next slide. The RCT cohort study did not find significant difference in the start of schooling for children. Next slide, please. Now, we can go to the household welfare and labor outcomes, second to the last group. There's no significant difference for household expenditures, although we find a statistical significant difference in the average total per capita income between Pantawid and non-Pantawid Pamilya using the policy RD results, the right figure on the right. And in terms of expenditures on education per child, you see here it continues to have a higher expenditures. The Pantawid Pamilya continues to have higher expenditure per child by about 35. And in addition to that, also from the same as the other other evaluation, Pantawid households also spend significantly more on clothing and footwear. This may be because this is related to schooling, and we find no impact on vice goods like alcohol and gambling. The qualitative study actually confirmed this result and found that most of the expenditures in are on of Pantawid beneficiaries are on the grant is pertains to educational expenses. Next slide, please. Now, on household income, in terms of household per capita income, beneficiary household is slightly higher income when grants are included, but not when it's not included by about 4,900 to 6,300, the left graph. But when you take that out, it's no longer significant. Qualitative study says that the purpose grants helps the beneficiaries in the purchase of their daily needs and schooling needs of the student. However, the grant amount needs to be adjusted given the rising price of goods. The household budget is usually not enough to cover the basic needs. These are the comments. Both beneficiaries and non-beneficiaries report having to adjust their spending to make it fit the other sources of income. Now, in terms of household welfare, we find that that there is a lower hunger incidence among beneficiaries by 4 to 6 percentage points, but there's no significant difference in terms of survey to poverty derived graph. Okay, in terms of labor force participation, there's no difference. What we find is a significant difference is in terms of employment by about 3 percentage points. This lower percentage. Lower employment rate is found among older workers, 55 to 64 years old, and in males and in rural areas. The lower unemployment rate of adults does not necessarily mean beneficiaries are discouraged to look for employment, and like labor force participation depends on both demand and supply, and the reduction in employment could mean the lack of jobs for the beneficiaries, as much as it could mean also a lack of workers willing to or available to accept the job. But if you look at the other jobs and work hours, you see that the Pantawid beneficiaries more Pantawid beneficiaries have other jobs by about 2.3 percentage points, and the compared to non-beneficiaries, Pantawid beneficiaries work 2 hours more per week compared to their counterparts. In terms of job-seeking behavior, next slide, please. We didn't find a significant difference in that. Now, this is the qualitative study, which is interesting for that the qualitative found that in urban areas, construction and laborers are the main jobs held by the breadwinners, mothers, and caregivers are engaged in selling to supplement household income. In rural areas, farm work and construction are the main jobs held by breadwinner, and mothers and caregivers usually stay at home. For labor market outcomes, the respondents mentioned that the following barriers to gaining regular employment or having a regular source of income. This is qualifications, usually education, age, and lack of jobs in the community, seasonality of jobs, as well as lack of capital to start a business. There is also a significant difference between urban and rural areas. In urban areas, availability of capital is the top concern, followed by educational attainment. Rural areas, however, the availability of jobs is the top concern, followed by availability of capital. So that's the issue of labor of the difference between urban and rural areas. Now, this is the last group on social behavioral outcomes. RED estimates show strong effect on EPS-related outcomes. There's a 26% percentage points higher. Next slide, please. To 32 percentage points higher attendees in Pantawid parenting sessions in the past 6 months. 6 out of 10 Pantawid beneficiaries participate in voluntary community activities. Pantawid Pamilya promotes ownership of evacuation kit by 11 percentage points. And there is also a 14 to 22% higher proportion of households who are officers of community organizations among Pantawid beneficiaries. Next slide, please. This is the special result on greed. We find that the Pantawid children have more greed than their counterparts, more asked to help with whatever the lesson is difficult, strive to finish the higher, to get higher grades, start to finish schoolwork before playing or resting, finish schoolwork despite lack of time and resources, and the overall grade, of course, is higher. Okay. Now we have two recommendations, and I'll maybe just run down to this. One is the strengthening the program aspects that employs the first 1,000 days of life to promote better health among women and young children, address the gaps in updating the changes in household composition, especially newborns and new pregnancies. Next slide, please. Strengthen the monitoring of the compliance of health conditions to capture better utilization of levels of available services by the beneficiaries. Do an in-depth study on the puzzling impact of nutrition. We already showed that. Next slide, please. Consider refocusing education intervention to older children where benefits are larger and children are more at risk of dropping out. Pursue studies that will analyze the impact of the program on learning, which we have not done until now. And 7, look for solutions to reduce child labor incidents and duration. Next slide, please. Identify, define more clearly, measure and monitor the knowledge, attitudes and practice that EPS wants beneficiaries to adopt. Number 9, take a cue from the results of the grid that the program should start doing studies that enhance the understanding of how the program may help promote or discourage socio-emotional skills. Number 10, there should be a continuous evaluation and updating of the grant amount. Next slide, please. Given the high compliance, the program may want to consider updating its program conditions and increase the number of minimum antenatal visits, reflecting the recommended and the ones recommended by the World Health Organization. This is actually 8. And now it's only 3 only required. Bolster health service delivery in rural areas in terms of staffing. We have shown that facilities and equipment and barriers to regular employment needs to be addressed. I think this is the last recommendation, and I thank you for your time. Listen.
Thank you very much, Dr. Orbeta, for that comprehensive presentation. Your presentation is very data intensive. I think you mentioned a number of problem areas based on your results. And correct me if I'm wrong. So you found high incidence of stunting among four-piece children, low postnatal visits of Pantawid mothers, the lower likelihood of being employed among Pantawid beneficiaries, and you mentioned the results, the reasons given by the respondents in the qualitative study, And then you also found that there was no reduction in the incidence of child labor, although working children are still able to attend school. Am I right, Dr. Arbeta? Those are among the problem areas or the you know, the gaps in terms of program impact that you found in your studies. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so friends, before we go to the next part of our webinar, I would like to get your pulse on one of the recommendations of the study team, that which refers to upgrading the grant amount. Because over the years, the value of the grant has diminished or has gone down due to yearly inflation rates since the program started. And as such, we would like to pose the following question. And all of our participants are encouraged to answer this poll. So our question is, should the program adjust the cash grants for inflation? Dapat po bang itaas ang ayuda para sa 4Ps bilang tugon sa pagtaas ng presyo ng mga bilihin? Yes or oo or no o hindi? So, maaari na po kayong sumagot ngayon? Okay. So, we are giving you a few seconds to answer that question. So, Gwen, let us look at the result. Okay, according to Gwen, our platform host, WebEx, the system is still computing the results. So again, this is the poll question, should the program adjust the cash grants for inflation? Dapat po bang itaas ang ayuda para sa 4Ps bilang tugon sa pagtaas ng presyo ng mga bilihin? Oo o hindi? Meron na ba tayong resulta? Okay, so mas mataas po ang nagsasabi or nagsabi na dapat niyang i-adjust ng programa ang cash grants to account for inflation o yung pagtaas po ng mga bilihin. So 95 po ang sumagot ng yes at ang no po ay 17, bagaman may mga hindi rin po sumagot. Pero in general, mas marami po ang nagsasabi na kailangan i-adjust po ang cash grants. So this is something for our government to think about, to consider. Okay, so and as a token of our gratitude for those who answered the poll, we will select two names randomly, and those two names will receive a PIDS notebook. Ito pong notebook natin. And I will announce the names before we close the webinar. So let us now listen to the comments of our discussants. And friends, we invited three experts. We invited Assistant Secretary for Policy and Plans Jocelyn Iwani of the Department of Social Welfare and Development, or DSWD. He is also the head of the Policy Development and Planning Bureau of DSWD. But before being based at the DSWD Central Office, she was at the DSWD Field Office of the Cordillera Administrative Region and the Ifugao Provincial Social Welfare and Development Office. A BMEDAL public servant, Asek Niwane has received numerous awards, including the Dangal ng Bayan Award from the Civil Service Commission. We also have our representative from the Department of Health in the person of Ms. Luz Tagunicar, who is a supervising health program officer at the Disease Prevention and Control Bureau of the Department of Health. She is also the designated national program manager for the Micronutrient Supplementation Program, Infant and Young Child Feeding Program, and the Philippine Integrated Management of Acute Malnutrition Program. Ms. Tagunicar is also a member of the National Advisory Committee Technical Working Group of the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program. And of course, we have our representative, our economist from the Economic Research and Regional Cooperation Department of the Asian Development Bank, Mr. David Reitzer. We invited the ADB because the ADB has been actively conducting studies, impact evaluation studies on the 4Ps. And Mr. Reitzer conducts impact evaluation of development interventions and research on environmental policy challenges and agricultural development constraints. In the COVID era, he has also become involved in modeling studies, as well as on a cost-benefit analysis on measures to control the pandemic. He has over 17 years of research experience in evaluating the effects and benefits of policies and interventions using a range of methods. We'll hear first from Asek Niwane, to be followed by Ms. Tagunikar and Mr. Reitzer. So over to you now, Asek Niwane.
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Wim. Good afternoon to each and everyone. Good afternoon, sir, and congratulations, Dr. Orbeta, and the team of evaluators for accomplishing these three studies under the third wave impact evaluation on the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program. Next slide, please. The strong points of the study are being able to present and describe properly the background of the program and the different interventions provided by the program to its partner beneficiaries and relating them to different levels of objectives and evaluation design that would provide necessary evidences for policy action, program, and enhancement. The manner of citing and providing results of previous program evaluations and other related literature to build stronger evidences and triangulation were also impressive. It was also noteworthy that the analytical framework and the methodologies of the study are well explained, especially on how the tools and techniques were introduced and described in relation to the program's framework. Next slide. The results of the study laid down sufficient evidences using the right perspective and assessment of the different program impacts, provided policy measures to provide the program implementation and service delivery. On reading the results, allow us to share our thoughts on the different findings. One, on reproductive and maternal health, the positive impact on the beneficiaries are evident on those directly related to compliance to conditionalities. However, for those not explicitly required for mothers or women to avail of, like family planning commodities and interventions, it must be noted that the Commission on Population Development, or PAPCOM, has key agency or is the key agency for convergence, helps ensure ways of assisting parents with unmet need for modern family planning to access its information and services. Likewise, the DSWD also ensures that availment of health services, particularly the pre and postnatal monitoring, are within the DOH guidelines and compliant to the Kalusugan at Nutrisyon ng Mag-ina Act. Next slide. On child health and nutrition, the Department's Supplementary Feeding Program, or SFP, may also be contributed to the observed reduction in prevalence of severe underweight, as it was also noted in the SFP process evaluation conducted by the SWD in 2020, that the program has been working well with the Pantawid Pamilya, noting that the children of Pantawid Pamilya families were encouraged to attend Child Development Centers, or CDC, school, and meet the 85% attendance due to the hot meals served through the SFP. Furthermore, the observed positive dietary practices may be influenced by the implementation of communal and background gardening of the parent, partner beneficiaries or the parents of the Pantawid Pamilya as a result of their family development sessions. Likewise, the National Nutrition Council, or the NNC, as one of the key agencies for convergence, ensures the alignment of the program's policies and guidelines of the Philippine Plan of Action for Nutrition, or PPAN, as well as assisting the monitoring and evaluation of compliance to nutrition-related conditions. The Department of Health or DOH, ensures the supply of health facilities and services are available in areas covered by the program. Next slide, please. On education and child labor, as one of the partner agencies of the Department of Education, or DepEd, ensures the alignment of systems to help implement, monitor, and evaluate the program operations, particularly on compliance of beneficiaries with education conditions, and ensure accessibility of supplies, facilities, and information for education. While the Department of Labor and Employment, or DOLE, keeps the DSWD updated on their initiatives to reduce the incidence of child labor, especially among the qualified household beneficiaries. Next slide. On household welfare and labor outcomes, it must be noted that qualified household beneficiaries shall be given priority in the availment of modalities and interventions under DSWD Livelihood, Sustainable Livelihood Program, or SLP, or the appropriate or similar programs offered by other government agencies or accredited private institutions in accordance with their policies and guidelines. Moreover, the effects on expenditure and income were observed in the study, although minimal, but the DSWD has been also putting continuous efforts to provide more financial literacy sessions through the Family Development Sessions, or FDS. Next slide. On the socio-behavioral outcomes, the DSWD shall pursue the discussion on systems integration to modernize the DSWD's information and communication technology infrastructure and to track the conditions and behavioral changes of poor PIDS beneficiaries. Likewise, the DSWD also ensures the continuity of conduct of FDS through electronic platforms and to implement strengthened youth development sessions, or YDS. Next slide. On the identified recommendations, it can be noted that with the institutionalization of the Pantawid Pamilya Pilipino Program and the strengthening of the convergence and national poverty alleviation strategy, it is expected that continuous technical assistance and collaboration between government agencies will be strengthened. Key partner agencies shall help each other monitor and evaluate the program operations, particularly on the compliance of beneficiaries with program conditions, and constantly provide the technical assistance among the agencies along health, nutrition, education, and overall socioeconomic development, to be more responsive to the needs of the beneficiaries. Along with this, monitoring and evaluation will also be ensured as systems and mechanisms will be in place as mandated by the law. The Pantawid Pamilya is already being case managed or doing case management to its beneficiaries. Along with this, monitoring and appropriate sanctions are provided to non-compliant beneficiaries and for further implementation of intensive care management as needed to identify and resolve barriers impairing the beneficiaries from complying with the conditionalities of the program. Next slide. In parting, we can say that the Pantawid Pamilyang Pilipino Program is continuously implemented as both a human capital development program and as the national poverty reduction strategy of the national government. The results and recommendations from the three studies are very helpful for the department's ongoing efforts in policy formulation, implementation, and coordination of social protection for the poor, vulnerable, and the disadvantaged. We are also confident that the DSWD, spearheaded by the Pantawid National Program Management Office, will study the identified recommendations for continuous evidence-based program enhancement. In fact, they are with us. Some of our partners, our listeners today and viewers are from the Pantawid Pilipino Program. So once again, thank you very much for this very impressive study, and thank you for helping the DSWD in its planning and monitoring. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon to Ma'am Josie. Thank you very much, ASEC Niwana. We greatly appreciate listening to your reactions to the presentation, as well as what the SWD intends to do to address the gaps seen in the evaluation. Of course, this will be in collaboration, in cooperation with the other implementers of the Pantawid, namely DOH, also DepEd, and also DOLE. Okay, so friends, let us now listen to the comments of our representative from the DOH, Ms. Luz Tagunicar. Ma'am, go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for, first of all, I would like to congratulate the PIDS for this very informative webinar forum. And we would like to thank the organizers for sharing with us the results and findings of the study, and of course, the opportunity to give our reactions for the study. So, let me go back to the specific results of the studies on maternal health. So we can see that in the prenatal checkup, at least once, it's already high for both groups, whether Pantawid or non-Pantawid. But of course, the availment of postnatal checkup is reported is low, both for Pantawid and non-Pantawid. And skilled birth attendance is high for both Pantawid and non-Pantawid. Respectively. So I would like to, since this is a qualitative study, I would like to really go back and reflect on the results of the PIDS study and compare it to the National Demographic Health Survey, the latest of which is 2017, which is just a year earlier from the date of the study. So indeed, ANC of at least once with, during the entire period of pregnancy is high, but the National Demographic Survey, just like the Pantawid results, had at least 87% for ANC visits. But if you can look at this, only 71 had their ANC in the first trimester. And this is what we would like also the study really to actually dig deeper and know exactly how much or how many of the Pantawid are really visiting the health center in the first trimester. Why the first trimester? This is very critical because the critical interventions like the introduction of the iron and folic acid during at the time or the onset of the pregnancy is very important because of the effect of iron deficiency in the neural tube defect. So ito po yung mga bata na lumalabas na may mga buko dito sa mukha or at the back or sa likod. So these are the things that we would like to really address. And of course, during the first trimester, all of the tests, the laboratory test requirements and the necessary services can earlier be started during the pregnancy period. So this is where we would like to focus. So if the National Demographic Health Survey is saying that only 71%, and the study is also saying that during the key informant interview, they're saying that many are not really being touched during the first trimester. So probably in the implementation of the 4-week program, we have to emphasize that an early consultation among pregnant women should be given emphasis. Now, look at this. This is the National Demographic Health Survey result also. But, the red shade is saying that there's 68% to 73% coverage for iron and folic acid supplementation among pregnant women. And this is important not only to prevent uterine tube defect and the poison the birth defect, but anemic women also tend to birth to a low birth weight infant, which is predisposing factor to stunting. So that's why we have to look also at the low birth weight among Pantawid, so that we can attribute it also to the high stunting rate among Pantawid Pamilya. So when it comes to delivery at home, both studies, including when compared to national demographic survey, say that the trend for more stillbirth attendance or delivery in health facilities are increasing, and home delivery is actually reducing. Now, look at this when we aggregate it, both in the lowest quintile and before the Pantawid, that's the tendency really to, although this is actually dispelled by the results of the findings, that more Pantawid are being attended by doctors based on the Pantawid, but generally, both in the lowest quintile, and I think this is one of the important results of the family development sessions and of course the counseling to Pantawid beneficiaries. But indeed, their birth assisted by the child health professionals are higher. And also generally, those with more children with the tendency to have birth at home. Kumbaga, sanay na silang mga anak. So, the more children they have, there's a tendency to give birth at home. Now, with regards to the specific child health education, regular weight monitoring of children is the most service that they're getting from the health center, although the coverage is still low at 27%. There's a higher vitamin A intake of vitamin A within 6 months. So vitamin A are given also, just like the deworming, are given twice a year. So those in the Pantawid have a higher uptake of vitamin A of every 6 months. And this is a good thing. But generally in the country, vitamin A supplementation has a higher coverage also, even during the time of pandemic, because this vitamin A is life-saving and it boosts the immune system, so it's very important that it be given. So there's no discernible impact on complete immunization. Exclusive breastfeeding is high, 81%, and higher likelihood of being fed vegetables are also higher. So look at this, the coverage of vaccination. So the administration coverage in 2017 is higher in region 2 and in few regions, but mostly the immunization program really suffered reduction in the past years because of the infrastructure. And I'm happy that in the study, the Pantawid are really not affected, with the compliance for immunization. It was not affected because of the being left care. But look at this. All the overall vaccination trend actually is going down. And the third dose usually is the one being affected. So third dose, because some of the mothers are not being able to go back to the health centers, or they have a connotation that if 2 out of 3 has already been given, then that's good enough. So that is the general attitude of the mothers. So it's very important to emphasize, especially if the immunization is given in 3 doses, it's very important to emphasize that the immunization doses should be given in full. If it is 3 doses, then it has to be given in full to have a full protection of children, including the Pantawid children. As far as anthropometric outcomes, there's no significant impact for underweight, wasting, and stunting. And the study also reported a higher prevalence of stunting among Pantawid beneficiaries. But let's look at the latest survey of the National Nutrition Survey. We can see that the prevalence of underweight, wasting, and stunting among the Pantawid is higher than the national average. So the Pantawid for prevalence for underweight is 25%, while the national average is 19. For wasting, it's 5.8, but for Pantawid, it's more than 10. And for stunting, it's 35 for Pantawid, and the national average is 28.8. So although stunting is higher among Pantawid as compared to the control group or to the comparison group, but generally looking at it, malnutrition or undernutrition is still a big problem in the Pantawid population, and we have to really look at this. Now, going back, the direct cause of malnutrition is inadequate dietary intake, and we can see that the hunger and poverty, self-declared poverty incidence is high among these. And of course, the disease, the more common is diarrhea and fever, which is also contributing to malnutrition. And this needs to be addressed by nutrition-specific interventions. And of course, the underlying causes would be income, poverty, employment, dwelling, assets, businesses. And of course, the basic causes would be more on the social and economic and political factors. And so if we look at this, malnutrition cannot be solved by all the interventions or the services being achieved or being availed of by the Pantawid. So, micronutrient supplementation, as well as getting the anthropometric measurements and giving counseling, it's not enough. These children or these families have to be linked with other interventions like the livelihood program of the DSWD, and of course the Department of Agriculture has to assist these families for home food production or community food production to increase the diversity of the food being consumed by their families. And for stunting, we have to go back at the preconception and pregnancy condition of the mother, because it will have a great outcome on or birth outcome or effect on the birth outcome. So we need to do interventions even during the adolescent age, during the pregnancy and the early part of birth. So that's why we have a spectrum of programs that will deal with the adolescent health. So we have adolescent health program and the safe motherhood program that look at the quality of the antenatal care, as well as for our infants and, of course, for the preschool children, as we focus more of our intervention also on understanding. So we need to link the Pantawid families more to these programs or to access services to this program, so that we can see impact also on stunting, particularly on stunting. So look at this, the trend of nutritionally at-risk pregnant women, and nutritionally at-risk pregnant women would tend to deliver to low birth weight babies. So it's 22.9. This is the total. But if we look at the lower age group, I mean the adolescent group, it's even higher, it's more than 30%. So we need to look also, and I think the Pantawid is a good intervention also, to keep our, especially our female adolescents in school, to prevent early pregnancy, teenage pregnancy. And then, of course, the prevalence of anemia, although it's reducing throughout the year, but it's still for pregnant, it's still in the minimum or the minimum level, and then the lactating is still at the mild level. So the pregnant is at the moderate level. So although it's reducing, it's still of public health significance that we need to address. Now, for many of the health facilities visited, particularly in rural areas, there's reported being understaffed and the ideal ratio of health personnel to community population. So let me inform everyone that we have what is called the HRH deployment program, and the criteria for deployment is that there should be at least one health worker per barangay, and we would, of course, be priority to geographically isolated and disadvantaged area. And then we need also to prioritize identified municipalities with indigenous people, and those in the 4, 5, and 6+ municipalities, and this are mostly in the rural area. There will be 36 focus areas of the Philippine Plan of Action for Nutrition, and then those that is geographically isolated. So as you can see, for barangay and rural health unit, it's more mostly government facilities, while the birthing home, infirmary, and hospital, there's a big percentage being run by the private sector. So for distribution of health facilities by region, you can see here, those in the red are the ones that have a higher number of facilities, but of course this is also in recognition that these regions have higher population than the rest of the region. And if you can see here, the LGU hired physician nurses and midwives would actually total to 26,699, while the DOH deployed would be 22,603. So meaning we almost match the number of human health human resources that has been hired by the local government unit. And I think some of the respondents also in the study acknowledged that the Department of Health is really augmenting the local health human resources in the country. So we have also deployment program for doctors, nurses, and midwives, and of course, dentists, med tech, nutritionists, medication, pharmacists, public health officials, and other types of health. Now, for future initiatives and development in the universal health care, that will be there will be established the province and citywide service providers network. So, In the implementation of the universal health care law, there would be a network composed of both private and public service providers network. So we would, the program would ensure that every individual is being given or being assigned a health service provider, a primary health service provider, so that they can avail of the health services. We are now currently developing the life stage package of services, so it can answer some of the findings that during the first 2 years and where immunization is there, many children are being brought to the health center for consultation, and after that, the only services that they can get is weight monitoring and not even counseling. So the life stage package of services, the DOH has identified package of services that will be financed both by Field Health, the Department of Health, and the local government unit to be able to provide services to all at different life stages. So for Mandanus ruling, that would increase the local government unit budget to allow them to take on more of the devolved function. So this is quite a challenge also to the Department of Health because of the devolved healthcare delivery system. And many of the municipalities, especially those in the 4th, 5th, and 6th class, cannot really finance all the needs for medicines and other commodities and logistics. But with the increased local government budget because of the Mandana theory, we are confident to transition many of the commodities to the local government unit so that availment and accessing of these commodities will be easier and will be more timely than if it is centrally procured and distributed by the department as well. And of course, there will be the data sharing agreement between Cohort and the Department of Health, so better compliance monitoring. So we have what we call the iClinic piece or the electronic medical record, wherein we can actually the management of Cohort can really check what kind of services is being availed by the Cohort beneficiaries without really going to the different health centers to check or validate what kind of services that they have availed from the health facility. So I think this is my last slide, and thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Tagunizar. We appreciate your effort to shed light on the gaps in health impacts of the 4Ps. We'll have time during the open forum in case our participants have questions with regard to the comments you presented. Okay, now let us go to the comments of Mr. David Reitzer of the ADD. David, over to you.
Okay, is my presentation being shared? I don't see my presentation now.
see it.
Okay. Sorry, WebEx is a little bit problematic for us. I only see gray. Do you see my first slide?
We'll just share your slide from here, David. I think that would be better.
I have refined a couple of small things, but it's okay. We can use that version.
Okay.
Let me try one more time. Let me just try using the share menu. Can you make me the presenter? I'll just try one more time with the share. Yeah, okay. Share. I used the button rather than the menu yesterday. So let's see. Now it's working. You see it?
Says starting to share content. We don't. Okay. Yeah, we can see it now. Okay. Yes.
Okay.
There you go.
Okay. Apologies for that minor technical glitch. I've had the. I'd like to commend the authors on a very good study. I've been involved in the study for a very long time, since 2017. I've been part of the technical working group. And we've had a very thorough consultative process, and I've really appreciated the patience of the team through all the feedback and discussions that we had. We spent countless days going through every aspect of the study, and I think it's a study that the team can be really proud of. I will spend a very brief period commenting on the study, then I will move on to some reanalysis that will shed some additional light on some of the most puzzling findings. So obviously the nutrition results are the results that are the most, that initially may be the most counterintuitive or possibly controversial. We have analysis that basically shows that actually this is in accordance with economic logic. It's a logical behavior of households. And we show how it's occurring and how it can be solved. I'll get to that in a moment. In terms of the study itself, the study is based on very rigorous methods in terms of the RCT, the RDD. RDD under a non-parametric design where sampling has been according to plans for use of the non-parametric design. It's very rigorous. The sample was very large. The authors have tried multiple bandwidths, and they've made a really solid effort to include relevant covariates. So the estimates that are presented are very well grounded, and they are presented under multiple bandwidths, under both a fuzzy and a sharp RDD approach. So we think that the authors really, they have quite robust findings under the main RDD study, because the methods are very sound. The RCT also, it's a gold standard design in that it was randomized initial allocation into the program. It's very unique that the study was able to follow up over a quite long time horizon to pick up the effects of being in the program earlier. And it has insights that are quite complementary to the RDD. Sorry, one bullet's in the wrong place. Both of the exercises used very comprehensive questionnaires. It was a 5-hour questionnaire in the field. It had countless modules. It got lots of detail. And it allowed the studies really to uniquely look at a large number of hypotheses and outcomes. And the qualitative study also really is complementary in terms of revealing supply side constraints and the perceptions of beneficiaries. So really it's an effort to be commended. What we find from the study is really in line with expectations if you think broadly. Basically, people are doing what they're subsidized to do under the program. And when I say subsidized to do, I mean the enforced conditionalities that affect whether they get paid. If we look at the conditionalities that beneficiaries are subjected to under the program, it's really the education conditionalities that are more thoroughly enforced. The health conditionalities, the enforcement has been in decline in recent years. And it's been in decline because new births and new pregnancies really aren't being reported to the program. And since they're not being reported to the program, then they're not being monitored by the program. There's, I believe the term is called beneficiary-driven registration of new pregnancies and births. And from a household perspective, you don't get more payment by reporting these pregnancies and births, but you have a higher risk that you won't get paid because all conditions need to be met to be paid. So basically, there's an incentive problem on the part of households. They don't report the new births because there's no positive incentive to do so. So basically, you know, most of the younger children, most of the new pregnancies, it's an unconditional cash transfer. And there's also more limited enforcement of the conditionalities, primarily for those births and for younger children, not for older children. For education, where the subsidies are really around enrollment and attendance, you see effects on enrollment. You see also participation in family development sessions, and you see beneficial knock-on effects of the FDS. The study wasn't able really to pick up longer-term outcomes. There was an attempt to look at educational progression and literacy and whatnot, and there weren't really significant effects that were found. So it's less clear whether the subsidized behavioral change that is happening where the subsidies are being targeted is really changing the longer term outcomes. And that's an important future research question. What has also been presented are the effects at the aggregate level. So they're the average effects on children in beneficiary households. But the effects within households are actually quite different. And The different effects within households can explain the strange, what may seem to be strange, nutrition results. So just as a reminder, we have a program. The program has a cap of 3 children. Children beyond the cap of 3 who can be monitored for educational compliance are not monitored at all for education. And on the health conditionalities, as you can see in this figure, new births, young children are not being registered for health compliance. So basically what we have is a CCT that's subsidizing education now, and it's only subsidizing education for some kids within the households. And the young kids who are measured for anthropometrics are, a much larger share of them would not be eligible for the education subsidies because of the cap on the number of children who are subsidized. So the fact that the program is effectively subsidizing some children within households who tend to be the older children, but not subsidizing children who tend to be younger in households. And this has important implications, because if we think about household behavior, there's a fair amount of evidence that households are resource maximizers. So the household is trying to invest resources in children and human capital so as to maximize income streams in the future. If you have some children who have subsidized education, other children in the household who don't have subsidized education, your returns to investment of health and nutrition and human capital in the kids with subsidized education are higher than your returns to investing in the kids who don't have subsidized education. And if you are behaving rationally as a resource maximizer, you will invest to the point that your marginal returns are the same across all the children. And that equilibrium will be at a higher level of investment in the children who get the educational subsidies than the children who do not. And you may even withdraw resources from the kids who don't get the educational subsidy and divert them into the kids who do get the educational subsidy. And that's because the kids with the educational subsidy are expected to have higher educational expectations and higher income because they will have more education. It may sound like a very harsh type of behavior. It's a type of behavior that's been documented in a range of contexts. It's not something specific to the Philippines, and it's actually perfectly logical. So we have done our own research to test, is this what's driving the effects that are being found in the impact evaluation? And we use the same data, and basically you'll see that this is what is driving the effects that are observed. In when we refer here in these slides to monitor, these are basically the kids who are subsidized for education. Because the other kids who are not monitored for education, the household doesn't get paid. There's no difference to payment for those households depending on whether their kids go to school or whether they don't. So effectively, the monitored kids are subsidized kids. So what we've done is we've picked up which kids in households have educational monitoring. But for kids who are not yet in school, we don't know if they're gonna be educated monitored for education with certainty yet. But what we do know is whether they have the possibility to be monitored, because there's a cap of three. So if in the household there are already three kids who are being monitored for education, the next younger kid cannot be monitored for education. So we have kids who have the possibility to be monitored because there are slots left for educational subsidies. And we have kids who don't have any possibility because all the slots are already occupied. So that way we can tag even for those who are not yet of educational age, whether they have the possibility to get educational subsidies. And we analyze on the basis of that. So now first, just some contextual information. This is not impact here. This is just the difference in means. But if you see and you look at this trend, the kids who are not monitored in the 4Ps households, you can see they are far worse off than the kids not in 4Ps households, whereas the kids who are monitored, who are subsidized, are better off. So that difference, though, is we don't know if that's a causal effect of the program, because there is a selection issue, and that is that the kids who are being monitored are being selected in the 4Ps households, but we're comparing to households that aren't having any role in terms of selecting kids. And originally the program had rules to select kids, then it is something that's now open selection. Okay, so what we do is we do an econometric trick. We basically use the econometric trick based on the selection rules that were initially in place until 2015. We use that to have something called an instrument that would predict whether a child is likely to be monitored. And we use that in combination with the same non-parametric fuzzy RDD design to be able to pick out the effect of being monitored. And we do it also with kids who have potential to be monitored. So that way we can solve for the selection that happens, and we can get a causal effect of being monitored in the program or not unmonitored in the program. And basically our instrument is the prioritization that was used by the program prior to 2015. So they had set rules. And according to those rules, we can rank the kids in the household and see whether they would come in the top three rank or not. For kids who are younger, who are born after open selection, then we just use whether the child is in the top three oldest of the household born during the period of eligibility. These instruments are quite good at predicting whether children are monitored, but in the households that are not in 4Ps, they have no effect on outcomes. So they work well as instruments. So what do we find? If we look at aspirations for children reported by parents, you see that in the monitoring eligible and monitored kids, the aspirations are significantly increased across a range of different indicators related to education. For kids who cannot be monitored, the aspirations are significantly decreased in terms of whether they will finish high school. Parents already are saying that these kids less than 4P's households will finish high school. If we go into child grit, which is a very good finding from the program in aggregate, we find the increase in grit only happens among the kids who will receive the educational subsidies. There's no increase in child grit among the kids who are not subsidized. And when we look at school enrollment, all the significant increase in enrollment happens only in the kids who receive the educational subsidies. And there's actually a significant decrease in enrollment for the kids who will not receive the subsidy. This is a significant decrease relative to kids not in 4P's households. Those kids are being pulled out of school in order to favor the kids and put the kids who are subsidized more in school. That's a causal effect of the program. And so parents are expecting that these kids will not finish school, they're pulling them out of school, and it corresponds to child health. They invest less in terms of their health and nutrition. So those kids are the kids that have the significant increase in stunting and being underweight and severe stunting. In our estimates, we did some additional data cleaning. So actually in the pooled effect, we no longer have significance. We focus on the nuclear family kids in the 4P households, not the sort of extended family kids, like the nieces and nephews who might be living in the household, grandchildren, et cetera. So we focus on the nuclear family around in an equivalent way. And so we don't have the pooled effect anymore, but we do have this highly significant effect in the kids who are not monitored. Those kids, the parents are expecting less of and they're investing less in compared to non-4Ps households. So we have a very clear explanation of why the stunting is occurring. So if we want to have more equitable outcomes, the program really needs to eliminate distortions in terms of the incentives for investment among children in the program households. The first step means monitoring needs to be expanded to all children. This next step means that the incentives have to be equalized. Either the cap has to be removed, or there has to be a penalty for the kids beyond three not attending school, so that that subsidies are equal across all the children, and the program wouldn't be picking favorite children who basically get increased human capital investment at the expense of other children who become the unfavored ones. It's not simple, and it's also not going to be simple in the context we're now in. We're talking about subsidies to increase educational enrollment. Right now, face-to-face schooling is not allowed in the Philippines. There's reliance on distance education, which is going to make effective education for 4P's households very, very difficult. They're not going to have good connectivity in many cases. The parents are not going to have the education necessarily to be able to serve as teachers. And you're going to have a whole generation basically that's behind and may drop out of school, which may exacerbate all of these challenges. So in the context of COVID-19, this is going to be a real challenge to address. So thank you.
Thank you very much, David, for your very insightful presentations and for sharing with us the results of ADB's own study assessing the impacts of the four P's. At this point, may I call on Dr. Orbeta for his response to the discussant's comments. ACO?
Okay. Yep. Okay. Let me thank first Assistant Secretary Niwani for recognizing the recommendations and saying that it will be part of the fine tuning, and we hope they can help there in terms of fine tuning the program, understanding the recommendations as well. And I'm glad that the department has started to look at those recommendations. For Dr. Tagunikar, we thank you for the nuanced discussions about health issues, and especially things like the proportions of the visit during the first trimester visit is very important, and we just treat all visits as the same, and then that's very, and also the reason for the medical reasons for the stunting and the nutrition results, and we thank you for giving us also a preview of what DOH has been doing in terms of along these areas. Hopefully that would in future analysis we can look at that and include that in our understanding of the results of the evaluation. And finally, I'd like to thank David for complimenting the efforts around the report. And finally, and this very nice insight that households are actually working, actually responding to the incentives. And this is a very interesting thought of understanding the reason for the results. And I think that's a very interesting thought to follow in terms of getting more from the David is calling intra-household incentives that's happening because of a rule. And I like very much the nuance recommendation of how to counteract these incentives are very important, like whether removing the cap or some intelligent way of changing the incentives and equalizing them so that there will be no favoritism among the children, that you will have a much better or a more welcome response from the households. I thank for that, David. And I think I'll stop there, and we can go to the open forum. Thanks for the thank you for your comments. Very very helpful and very insightful.
Thank you very much, Dr. Urbeta. We have received numerous comments and as well as questions in our chat box. So at this point, we will now open the floor for questions. And let me first. Before we proceed to the open forum, allow me to acknowledge the presence of Congresswoman Dalia Loyola, Congressman Dalia Loyola, Chair of the House Committee on Poverty Alleviation. Thank you, ma'am, for attending our webinar. Okay, so let me read some of the comments of our participants. Okay, and this one is from Asik Carlos Abad Santos. He said, before addressing the issue of increasing the grant amount, for which we had a poll a while ago, we need to address program design and or implementation issues given the results of the impact evaluation, which are underwhelming. And we have seen what those gaps are. And one of the gaps also, aside from health and nutrition, and as well as on child labor that was mentioned, pertain to the to monitoring issues. And according to Sheila Manzanilla, comprehensive monitoring and evaluation must be implemented. Mr. Antonio Avila said that he supports the recommendation that there should be strict monitoring of the compliance of beneficiaries through regular reporting every time they get their allowance. Also, random visits should be conducted by the SWD to validate the reports of the beneficiaries. There's also Emilita Oro. She said that results are pointing out about room for enhancing the design of the four Ps with better integration of nutrition interventions and conditionalities, and she agrees with the need for better coordination, especially in the areas of follow-up monitoring at the local level. It's good to know that you know, most of our participants are agreeing with the recommendations of our presenter, as well as those mentioned by our discussants. From Melanie Tehol, it seems that the DOH data presented cannot clearly show the health outcomes of 4Ps beneficiaries. Perhaps the DOH and the SWD should coordinate on their data sets for better programming and monitoring in their interventions. I think Ms. Tagonicar mentioned about having a data sharing agreement between DOH and the SWD to monitor health and nutrition outcomes of the program. Now, let us start entertaining some questions from our audience. And let me start by reading the question of Dr. Mohar Mangahas. He said, has there been a negative effect of the lockdowns on the provision of cash transfers to the 4Ps beneficiaries? And may I throw this question to Asek Niwane of the DSWD? Asek?
Yes, ma'am. During the lockdown, there are concerns on how to be able to let our people receive their cash, even if it is through the ATM, because it is hard for them to get out during lockdowns. But after the easing of the lockdown, they were able to receive their cash grants. Conditional grants by going to the ATM booths or our SDOs, other beneficiaries could go directly to the banks. But it did really hampered their immediate receiving of their cash grants. Yes.
Okay. Thank you very much for your response, Asek. Actually, I have my own question with regard to the lockdown, with regard to the COVID-19. So, do you foresee a negative effect in the school participation of the 4Ps children, given the shift to the modular distance ed and online learning? And have you seen, or has the SWD, have you seen the enrollment of 4Ps children been sustained? Has it been sustained? Are they still attending school? And do we have the percentage of 4Ps children who are into modular distance education or online learning? Has DSWD been monitoring this? Or perhaps But any inkling, ma'am, on the probable effect of this shift to modular distance ed or online learning?
It is, there is a very big impact because as of now, especially those who are in the JIDA areas, it's very hard for them to really have the digital automation kind of learning. But the modular, even the modular, because they still have to bring the, it's either the teachers bring the modules to
the
their
modules.
Children, yes, or the children have to go to the school to get their modules. So yes, it is still very hard, and it's a big adjustment for all our children, whether they are for peace or not. I think they are experiencing the same. And more so for our 4Ps, especially if they are big families. So they don't have the gadgets to use for this kind of blending or purely digital way of teach module or the modules itself. Mm-hmm. And of mm-hmm. course, we all know that it's very hard for the parents who are not also educated to teach their kids or tutor their kids on this. So that is making things very hard for both the parent and the child.
Yeah, indeed. Yeah, expectedly. And Dr. Orbeta, we assume that the effect of the COVID on the 4Ps will be covered in the next wave of impact evaluation.
Yes, that's correct. We have a little bit of maybe to answer Mahal's questions. The redeeming part of the program, one redeeming part of the program, it was easy for the government to distribute the SAP because like for example, the SAP was intended for 18 million households. The 4 million was easily quickly disbursed because it's are disbursed through ATMs. So the only so it's a very fast. The only reason, the only problem perhaps is on the other end, wherein the when the 4P beneficiaries cannot get into an ATM or where they can get their money. So, but the distribution itself, we even have 4P beneficiaries who thought that they were the PT, the others where the names have still to validated because theirs is already there's a system for transferring money with them, and it was, and when we asked them through online survey, they got their money right away. And that's the response.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Okay, and ACO, since you're already there on the screen, so perhaps I can ask you the next question, which pertains to the shift to a universal social protection. And these questions are from one is from Oli Lucas and the other is from Joseph Solis Alcaide Albirizzi. So according Oli is asking if shouldn't we be moving away from improving 4Ps to taking lessons from the program to applying it to a universal social protection program? And then Joseph Solis Alcaide asked if said that he is suggesting that probably the 4Ps could be transformed into a more inclusive social welfare program, like a universal basic income for every Filipino individuals aged 16 years old and above. Can I ask your comment on this first? Then perhaps we can also ask David's response on this question.
Yeah, that's a very nice idea, actually, of universal basic income. The problem with that is that how do you finance it? If you give everybody money, where do you get the money? And here is a very clear reason why you're spending money. You are protecting the children from being uneducated and unhealthy. That's where the money is going. Children of the poor will never get education because their families doesn't have money, and if you could just look at their attendance, their health conditions, because education and health will be not too much a priority for them. So you're protecting these kids from going to the cycle. Basically, that's what we are protecting here. We're not. So if you have like universal, everybody wants to get free money. But you should have a reason for that, because money mm-hmm. is not free. It's scarce. That means you get money from here. You maybe don't have money for infrastructure. It's needed for growth and all of that. So there is a trade-off that people have to think of. It's always nice to have universal things, but mm-hmm. the cost of that has to be thought of, and the reason for doing that has to be thought of. Because some people would not need universal income. Only a few people have subsidies. Only few people like they have subsidies. You cannot have your children go on for life without being educated because their parents are poor. That's what you're investing on. That's what this project is investing on. You're investing on those children by virtue of their circumstances. They cannot be educated if their parents are poor. That's what society is investing in.
Okay, thank you for sharing us your thoughts, Dr. Orbeta. David, may we get your insights on this, universal social protection versus more targeted interventions?
Thank you. It's a very good question. I tend to agree with Dr. Orbeta that universal basic income would not be something that would really help to break this human capital investment problem. What we see is the increased human capital investment happens because of the conditionalities. It isn't happening in areas where the conditionalities are not being enforced. So in order to increase that investment, the conditionalities are important. Now, in terms of universality, though, there is an issue, and that's that the Listahanan 1 that was used to select 4P's beneficiaries is really out of date. It's from 2009, basically, in terms of the data collection, and there are new households, there are new poor, and so there does need to be a way that new poor get identified much more rapidly, that it is able to capture new poverty from new situations such as the COVID-19 lockdowns. So they're a more dynamic social protection system that's able to capture new poor and is also supplemented by additional social protection policies is useful. So for all the policies, though, it's important to keep in mind, what are we subsidizing and is that behavior something that's socially beneficial? So just as another example where you would expand social protection because you subsidize good behavior would be, say, to introduce paid sick leave programs as a complementary kind of tool, because that incentivizes people not to go to work, not to go out into society when they're potentially infectious of others. It can help in, say, COVID-19 control. So introducing more comprehensive social protection policies would be useful, things that capture more situations where people are in need, but it's useful to keep them always targeted so that they're subsidizing basically beneficial behavior rather than just providing money unconditionally. So I hope it's not too complicated an answer, but something more universal is helpful, more dynamic, but it still should be conditional. Thank you.
And thank you, David. Okay, let's entertain another question. And this time, this is from Executive Director Merwin Salazar of the Senate Economic Planning Office. He said, the study showed that little or none at all change was observed in the relevant health and education indicators between beneficiaries and non-beneficiaries of 4Ps. Hence, one cannot make a causal inference that 4Ps is an effective and relevant intervention to achieve the desired change in the behavior of mothers and children. Is this right? Did the 4Ps identify in its program concept the desired changes or targets in the cited health and education indicators after a certain period of implementation? Okay. Perhaps we can get first the response of Asek Niwane, ma'am. Hello, Asek.
Yes, yes. We have a every yearly survey on the level of well-being of our social well-being of our beneficiaries. So it is there where we were able to see if they have moved from a higher level or they maintained their baseline. So that's what we are doing. That is done yearly. And but of course, for 2020, there was no such thing due to the COVID. We were not able to get the data for 2020. But we have for 2019, which we can later share with everybody. That is our way of monitoring as of now.
Okay.
ever we need, I think, to have some changes or modification due to the pandemic.
Mm-hmm.
And we are monitoring it. Sheila, can I answer that?
Yes, go ahead, Dr. Urbeta. There's a second part of the question which refers to the identifying in the program concept the desired changes or targets in decided health and nutrition indicators after a certain period of implementation.
Okay, I think the way you look at the results, like for example, in enrollment in the enrollment in 6 to 11, there's no significant impact. What it means is that because the program is there, the Pantawid are at par with their counterparts, which are non-eligibles. Remember, the counterparts are non-eligibles. That means they are richer than the poverty threshold. That means that because of the program, they were at par. Removing the program, you will go back to the previous problem of enrollment being below for poor households. That's precisely it. So the having greater impact than your counterparts are non-eligibles is actually a gravy already here. Just keeping them there and that part is already a result of the program. Essentially, that's what it means to me. Of course, that's I'm just discussing about so-called insignificant result. So. But there are significant results, like for example, enrollment for 12 to 15 years old, and so they're higher enrollment, even higher than their counterparts. That should be appreciated in that sense. If you remove the program, you'll go back to your old problem, which is poor households not keeping their children in school. So this is basically what we are trying to solve. Over the long term, I think that just to the way to look at so-called that little impact, essentially.
Mm-hmm.
These are people, poor people, being compared to those who are not so poor, not eligible to the program.
Okay.
By the way, it was designed.
Yeah. David, go ahead.
I just wanted to add a couple of points. I think what the results show is that it is effective when the conditionalities are enforced. So enforced conditionalities, the beneficiary households change their behavior to respond to the conditionalities, and we find significant effects. And the increased enrollment is a very important significant effect. And that justifies more than the administrative cost of the program, just the enrollment effect. So if you think about the transfers themselves are not really a cost to society, it's just moving money back and forth. It's really sort of more the apparatus of administering this kind of a program. And just that one effect alone justifies all the costs of administering such a program. Program could be much more effective if more conditionalities are enforced. And in the early days, when the health and nutrition conditionalities were better enforced, one found significant effects of those. If they go back to, if they're enforced like they were in the early phase of the program, you also get those significant effects as well. It's really a matter that the study does show that households respond to the conditionalities. So if the conditionalities are set appropriately, you'll get the expected benefits in terms of behavioral change. Thank you.
And David, one of the your recommendations extending. Yes, Ms. Tagunicar, go ahead, ma'am.
May I also add that because of the COVID in the past in our study and the National Demographical Survey saying that the poorest quintile are accessing the health services less and less. And with the results or findings of the study, most of the preventive and promotive interventions are being accessed by the poorest beneficiaries at par or at the level of the non-Pantawid beneficiary population. And this is a very good improvement because in our studies, the poor are the ones that are less accessing their services. Mm-hmm. Because of their conditionality, indeed, they are responding to the conditionality. Thank you.
Okay. Ms. Tagunikar, if I may have some follow-up questions for you related to the health aspect of the 4Ps. We received some questions regarding the growth monitoring. And because we have this Operation Timbang, and Angelian Villanueva and Adonna is asking if does this mean that Operation Timbang is not reaching the Pantawid children? Hello? Miss Luz?
Operation Timbang actually is being conducted by the National Nutrition Council. This
okay.
is done annually, and it is weighing all children, including the Pantawid beneficiaries.
Mm-hmm.
So
okay.
That, we can, but yes, it is a mass weighing, meaning all children under five is being weighed, and they are classified as to the nutritional status. So each barangay health station or rural health unit would have a data on the weight and height of these children.
Okay. There's a question here from Anita Baleda. What could be the reasons why Pantawid beneficiaries have a higher incidence of stunting? I think you mentioned some of your insights in your presentation. If you could kindly, just make a summary in response to this question.
Yes, as I have said, stunting is more complicated because the outcome or the stunting will be traced back to the pre-pregnancy condition. So during the adolescent years, if the adolescent is not well nourished and she becomes a mother, and if no prenatal checkup as well as interventions during pregnancy, then there's a likelihood that the birth outcome will be also poor. Like the mother will give birth a low birth weight child, and low birth weight is a major risk for stunting. And may I say that after 2 years, if a child is stunted, this is irreversible. The child will be stunted forever, as far as height is concerned. Mm-hmm. Okay, and it would also have a long-term impact on the cognitive or mental development of the child. So this is very important, aggressive stunting. But it has to go back from preconception, and it will require a whole of government interventions, like VA providing access and availability to food, VSWD providing livelihood and other social protection, and of course, the health should be more aggressive in providing health and nutrition interventions, including supplementary feeding programs. And the local government units would have a critical role in implementing all these interventions. And because the health system is devolved, the capacity of the local government units to implement these interventions really varies, no? Depending on the capacity or income of the municipality, as well as the priority being provided by the local civic society. So there's a big variation really in how these are being implemented. So it has to be the whole of government, and it should be given.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Thank you very much for emphasizing that, Ma'am Luz. Okay. In one of David's recommendations is monitoring the impact beyond, you know, the 4Ps beneficiary. So sort of extending the monitoring to all 4Ps, to all children. Okay. And may we have may we know your thoughts on this, Dr. Orbeta and Asek Niwane. May we hear first from Asek Niwane. Hello, Asek.
Yes, kindly repeat the question, please.
Okay. One of the recommendations of David in his presentation is that in order for the program to eliminate distortions in investments on children, we need to extend the monitoring to all children, non-4Ps as well as 4Ps. I mean, even the children that are not covered by the program, the sort of
the other children,
yes. Can you comment on this?
Yeah, actually,
because there's a cap of 3 children. Okay, there's a cap of 3 children, so he is suggesting that we monitor all children or cover those beyond the 3 children cap.
That is also being considered. However, really the focus is on the 3 children. If the family has 5 children and all of them are all going to school, we try to look into all of them. However, when we do the focus reporting, we have to really look into the 3 children who are enrolled to the 4Ps.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the, but in the case management component, the 5, all the children or the whole family is being monitored.
Ah, okay. So all of them are being monitored.
Yes, but okay. When we talk about the impact of the program, we really look into the children who are enrolled.
Children who are enrolled.
Yes.
Okay. And any thoughts, ma'am, on the still high incidence of child labor? I mean, although there's a good side to the result, because even though if these children are working, they are still in school. But still, there's still this high incidence of child labor, which is not good.
Yeah, we discourage child labor, we always we have to do a lot of advocacy on this. But I think it's a little bit hard sometimes, especially when it's harvest time in the rural areas. We cannot really force the parents not to let their children go to school. However, I think it has lessened, because we always sometimes inform them that if you do not allow your children, then that's part of the conditionalities, then automatically the child could not receive the allowance that is supposed to be given to the child. So that's but we cannot force, of course, the parents from that kind of system. However, we keep on informing them about the effects of child labor. And we do this most of the time in the FDS of the family, family development
sessions.
Slowly.
Do you think it has something to do with the amount of the grant? I mean, perhaps it's not sufficient. That's why to augment the family income, then some of the children still need, especially the older children, still need to work, you know, to help their parents.
Yeah, if we really look into the realities, it is not enough, especially if they have other siblings who are not enrolled. So what they do is they share the grant with their siblings, even if we tell that they don't do that, but we cannot force them not to do that. Mm-hmm. So that's actually the limitation of the program. If the program could expand to until the whole family or the children, the probability, there's a tendency that the amount could be enough. But at this point, it's a... we all know that we are limited. We have limited funds for this, so we only have to limit it to 3, that is where the, so that maybe that parents could have will only support the rest of the children. But yeah, we with this pandemic, it's harder, I think.
Okay. There's a question from one of our participants related to the mandanas, which we'll Mandanus ruling, which will take effect next year. And from, yes, sir, Dr. Arbeta, go ahead po.
I think, yeah, I would just like to answer about the monitoring of all children. We actually has been recommended before because of the fact that when we do the evaluation, we count all the children. So if the children are not monitored, then we need to be. And actually, what David has shown us is that there's an economic reason for those results, and the incentives are not the same. So households will invest on those who are monitored rather than those who are not. So that strengthens the argument that we should be monitoring all the children regardless. And I just saw in the chat that actually the new law doesn't have a cap anymore.
A cap, sabi nila. I think this was ASEC Abad Santos clarified this.
That's one.
Parang nakita ko dito.
Yeah, that's one blunt solution that David has mentioned, removing the cap or creating sophisticated incentive scheme that will equalize the among children, so that you will have this, don't have this strategic behavior that David has pointed out. So that should perhaps be looked at in terms in the case of so. The default case is monitor all children. If not, create a scheme which will be much more difficult to equalize the incentives across, so that you will not have this behavior that is creating problems with measuring the outcomes. Mm-hmm. I think that's the major point David has pointed out.
Oh, yeah. But can the government afford it? Yun din ang tanong ni Lourdes Mendoza. If you remove the cap. Anyway, I think the question is for another webinar. Let's entertain a couple of more questions. This is with regards to the Mandanus decision. What is the implementation of the Mandanus decision on the redesign and implementation of Pantawid? Do we assume it will continue to be national via the SWD, or one way or another the cash transfers or conditionalities will be localized, and therefore there will be local variations that will make program management and evaluation more complex? What is being done to prepare for this? Perhaps we can ask Niwane, ano ba yung magiging may meron pang impact itong Mandanus ruling sa program design and implementation ng Pantawid, ma'am?
For the Pantawid, this is one of the programs that we cannot devolve so far. Mm-hmm. Under the Mandanus ruling, due to the fact that it's still still funded by foreign, we still have infusion of funds from the foreign monies, and also under the law that was recently passed last year, that the SWD will have to handle yet the 4Ps. So far, the agreements are still the same with the LGUs, that we have to be able to help them until 7 years. So after the 7 years, we are testing now the graduation program, wherein the LGUs will have a very big part, because they will now be the ones who will be helping these families who will be graduating to maintain their level of economic status and be able to sustain them. So we are closely coordinating with the LGUs on how to be able to do this and how they will be doing the aftercare after the 7 years program is done.
And so perhaps one of the questions that I saw from the chat box, medyo mabilis lang talaga kasi yung pagdami ng questions, is that what will happen to the, are there other programs of the SWD or other government agencies that support Pantawid beneficiaries, perhaps after they have graduated, or perhaps, yung Pantawid families, kasi you have this SLP, diba, perhaps you can say a bit say something about these programs para lang sa ating mga audience?
Oh yeah, actually, even if they are not they are not yet graduated from the program, the SLP is already assisting, but the other agencies are also assisting, like DOLE, even especially the LGUs are really into assisting these families. And as I said, once they graduate, the LGUs really help them, should help them maintain their level of economic status, that they should not go back to being really very poor again, to be able to sustain their income. So the other agencies, the NGAs and these non-government agencies, are also helping in the aspect of livelihood. So yes, TESDA is helping, DOLE is helping, DTI, and the rest of the agencies are actually, even DPWH hires the, prioritizes also the hiring of Pantawid families, family members. Yes. So okay. It's a whole nation approach.
That's right. Okay. Since this webinar is about the impacts of the Pantawid, allow me to read one of a comment from one of the beneficiaries of the program, and who goes by the name of Nenita Reyes. Sabi niya, for me po as a beneficiary of the program, I can proudly say that there is positive impact on our family. Sa akin, sabi niya, as a parent and a leader, I have been empowered not only for myself but the community. My children benefited sa health and education. Sa ngayon po, my youngest is third year BS psychology student sa Our Lady of Fatima University. And na-prioritize po siya dahil for peace po kami, kaya sobrang thankful po ako sa program. Okay, there are still other questions from our chat box, but I'm afraid we don't have time left to answer all of them. But I appreciate the initiative of some of our fellow participants for answering some of those questions, particularly sina Asek Kaloy Abad Santos. Thank you, sir, for answering the some of the questions po. Also, kanina nakita ko yung ating representative from the DSWD has been answering questions on how to join the 4Ps. Okay. I think we have already covered almost all of the questions. So at this point, if I may ask Asek Niwane, being the primary, the DSWD being the primary program implementer of the 4Ps, to say something to our audience, kung meron po kayong gustong sabihin.
Thank you very much, ma'am. So we really appreciate the study conducted by Sir Orbeta for the, and of course, my co-discussants. Thank you very much for all the inputs. Yes, we are happy that this is done, this webinar is done, and we would do our best to really consider all the recommendations, think about it, and work on the things that we can at our level. If necessarily, we will ask for your help in advocacy, especially in the possibility of increasing the
amount of
grants that could be done, and of course to enforce the conditionalities and the monitoring. So thank you very much for all the findings. We appreciate this. It's helpful to management and for planning purposes. So once again, we appreciate this webinar. And to everybody who has been participating, we thank you for giving us this opportunity to be discussing with you and to join you in this very important concern of the department itself and everybody. So stay safe, God bless, and see you again next time. Thank you very much.
Maraming salamat din, ma'am. Marami pong salamat. If we may hear also something from Ms. Luz. from the DOH? Baka may gusto kayong sabihin, just a brief words po. Miss Luz, nandiyan pa ba kayo? Hello?
Yeah, I'm still here. Sorry.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, brief words lang po. Brief message.
Well, thank you for this study. At least we know the gaps and what we need to improve. This is the purpose or the objective of doing this study. And we, as part of the intervention, the provision of intervention, will be guided and together with the local government units, really exert more and more effort really and improve the delivery of health and nutrition interventions to make a good impact. And as I had said, there's no perfect program, but at least we can see some, and I personally, as part of the National Advisory Committee, we can see really some improvement in the families. At least 45,000 have been graduated in the program. And even if we are not really changing all of the lives of these 4 million families, at least we're making some difference or movement from one level to another. I think naman talaga yung excellence ang pagbigay ng interventions or the improvement, but we're able to move them from where they are to the next higher level. So thank you to be part of this.
Salamat din sa inyo po sa DOH, Ms. Luz Tagunicar. David, would you like to say a few words? Just in case you have, you know,
Okay. I would just like to thank DSWD and PIDS for the excellent collaboration we've had around this impact evaluation study. It's been a real privilege to be able to be part of this process from the beginning through now to dissemination. So we appreciate it. We look forward to working together with DSWD and PIDS into the next phases of the program and into the next impact evaluation. So we have appreciated the teamwork, and we commend the team for an excellent effort. It's also served as the basis for our research as well. So thank you, and thank you for the opportunity to also share some of our supplemental insights. We appreciate it. So, thank you to the participants for staying on to the end.
Thank you to David. And Dr. Arbeta, a few words, if you have any, something to say to our audience. Yes.
Yeah, thank you for the insights on the report, and the report will be on our website. So if you have comments, we would gladly receive them. We have an email address in the report that you can, on our website, you can send your comments, things that you have been able to say and not able to respond. Perhaps you can send that to you. And thank you for being here, actually.
Yes, indeed. It's already, we have exceeded our time limit. I think so many are interested to hear the results of the studies. And we thank everyone for attending. Actually, there are lots of takeaways that we can learn from today's discussion. And if I may give one, I think this is the fact that the 4 P's by itself is not a panacea or a cure-all for the economic and social problems that are affecting our impoverished countrymen. The necessary conditions should be present for the program to meet its objectives. For example, we need to ensure that health and school facilities are available and accessible to the beneficiaries, and that the quality of the services are also acceptable. Our health and education system should also be we should also have enough and competent human resources in health and education, and that this should also be accessible even in the far-flung areas of the country. The program also depends on favorable macroeconomic conditions on available, reliable, and accessible infrastructure and appropriate policies to provide better employment and entrepreneurial activities. And the absence of any of these factors could hinder the achievement of the program's objectives. Friends, please join me in thanking Dr. Orbeta, our discussants, Mr. David Reitzer, Mr. Lusta Gunikar, and ASEC Joseliniwane for the insights that they have shared with us this afternoon. So let's give them a big virtual clap. And thank you also to those who participated in the Q&A, those who have shared their insights as well as those who asked questions during the open forum. Maraming salamat po. And before we finally close, I would like to announce the two winners who will receive the PIDS notebook. They are Kathleen Almonte and Maria Grace. Tama ba? Maria Grace Moralde. I repeat, Kathleen Almonte and Maria Grace Moralde. Our team will get in touch with you for your delivery address. And finally, we have some reminders before we finally close our webinar. Okay, so friends, you may get copies of the presentations from the PIDS website as well as the links to the full studies. Next is on our feedback survey. So every webinar, we send you a feedback survey, and please answer that webinar so we know how to further improve our events. Also, please continue following us on our social media pages. We thank all those who watch our live stream on Facebook. A while ago, I was monitoring it. We had, I think, more than 200 Facebook viewers, and from WebEx, we had a little more than 200. Yes, so maraming salamat po. And also, thank you also to those who followed our live tweets on Twitter. And then, watch out for our remaining webinar this February. We have one on February 24, which is a Wednesday. It's not a Thursday, but a Wednesday, because February 25, I think, is a holiday, no? So we will be presenting the Institute's Labor Market Analysis of S&P Human Resource Needs in the Philippines. So we hope you will join us again in that webinar. And finally, we would like to thank all the representatives, all the participants from government, the various government agencies, private sector, civil society, academe, as well as the media who attended our webinar this afternoon. So we hope to see you again in our events here at PIDS. So we hope you have learned something valuable from our webinar this afternoon. So please stay safe and healthy and stay informed too. Thank you very much and enjoy the rest of your day. Maraming salamat po.